Welcome to part 7 of this Unity tutorial series, where we're creating a survival shooter game using Unity's new implementation of the Entity Component System pattern, or Unity ECS for short. In part 6, we continued our work on player shooting by implementing rate of fire, which is kind of a weird thing to do considering we haven't even begun generating bullets yet. But don't worry, because in this video, that's exactly what we'll be doing, and we'll be wrapping up player shooting once and for all. So, without further ado, let's get right into the video. So far, we've created two systems for player shooting system and cleanup firing system. At a high level, the player shooting system is responsible for tagging the weapon entity with a firing component whenever the player presses the Fire 1 button, and the cleanup firing system is responsible for untagging the weapon entity after a set period of time, which for now, is just hard-coded to be half a second. But all of this is happening in memory, so to speak. No bullets are actually being generated in the scene. It's time to fix that. First, we'll need to create a new system. Let's call it firing system. This system will be responsible for generating bullets, and a lot of them. So it'll need to leverage the C# job system. We can do this by having it extend the job component system class. Bullet generation means it'll need to be able to create new entities, so we'll need to inject a barrier. For the uninitiated, barriers are used to queue up actions that we want to perform on entities, from creation to modification to destruction. Barriers live on the main thread, where it's safe to perform these actions, as opposed to inside of our jobs, which are run on separate threads in parallel. And of course, we'll need to inject it. If you've been watching this series, then this should all look pretty familiar. But we're going to try out a new type of job this time, so the next step will be a little different. Let's create a job called firing job that derives from iJob process component data. Wow, that's a mouthful. Basically, this type of job processes entities based on their components. We can tell it which components to look for through its generic properties. In this case, we're looking for entities that have a firing, position, and rotation component. The firing component acts like a notification. When an entity is tagged with it, the job knows it's time to generate an actual bullet. The position and rotation components instruct the job where to generate the bullet in the scene and in what direction it should travel. Let's implement the job's execute method, where all of the action will happen. And I'll just quickly clean up the argument names while I'm at it. Next, we'll add an entity command buffer field to the job. The entity command buffer will be responsible for queuing up the creation of our bullet entities. Lastly, we'll need to overwrite job component system's onUpdate method and schedule the firing job. iJob process component data's schedule method is a little different from the ones we've seen before. It's specialized for ECS, so all it takes is a reference to the system and a job handle object. Alright, now it's time to generate bullets. Right after we do one more thing. We need a way to configure the mesh and material of our bullets. To this end, we're going to create a mono behavior that exposes a mesh instance renderer through a static field. The common naming convention here is bootstrap, or the name of your game followed by the word bootstrap. For now, I'll just stick to bootstrap. Now we can add a static mesh instance renderer property. I'll call it bullet renderer. Mesh instance renderers are components that are used by the mesh instance renderer system. The mesh instance renderer system is responsible for rendering 3D models in the scene. It's one of the handful of systems that comes bundled in with the entity's package. We'll actually be using another one of these bundled systems very shortly, but let's not get ahead of ourselves. I'd like to be able to configure this variable from the editor, so let's create a serialized field with the same name. Then implement the awake method and use it to initialize the static renderer. Now, we can switch back to the firing system and use the static bullet renderer to generate bullet entities. First, we'll use the entity command buffer to queue up the creation of a new entity from the execute method of the firing job. Then, we could add the bullet renderer component to it, which is a shared component. But this isn't quite enough. The mesh instance renderer system only operates on entities that have both a mesh instance renderer component and a transform matrix component. So let's add that as well. Now we can use that other built-in system that I mentioned earlier, one called the move forward system. I actually made a video recently on automated testing where I explain this system in more detail and demonstrate how you'd write unit tests for it. Definitely check that one out. But basically, the move forward system operates on entities that have a move forward, move speed, position, and rotation component. It propels these entities forward in the seed based on the data contained within those components. Move forward is a tag that operates just like the firing component. It just tells the move forward system that this particular entity needs to be acted on. The move speed component simply tells the system how fast the entity should move. And the position and rotation components are used to determine where and in what direction the entity is moving at any given time. We'll grab those from the entity with the firing component, which in our case is the weapon entity. All right. Now we can switch to the editor and see this baby in action. First, we'll need to add the bootstrap script to the scene so we can configure the bullet renderer. We'll also need to create a material that has GPU instancing enabled. You can find the checkbox for GPU instancing underneath Advanced Options. Now we can set up the bullet renderer. I'm just going to use the built-in sphere mesh for now. Now we can start the scene, and hey, what gives? Let's take a quick look at the entity manager. Our system seems to be generating a series of bullets instead of just the one that we were expecting. Why is that? Let's take another look at the firing system. The firing system generates a single bullet every frame for each entity that it finds with a firing, position, and rotation component attached to it. We tag the weapon entity with a firing component when the player presses the fire one button, but we don't untag the entity until after half a second has passed. So the firing system will generate a bullet every frame for an entire half a second. How do we fix this? Are we going to need to rewrite our entire player shooting logic? Luckily for us, the answer is no. We can turn the firing system into a sort of reactive system that'll operate on the entities we want based on changes made to their components. In this case, we'll have it operate on entities that have a firing, position, and rotation component, but only during the frame that the firing component was added. To do this, we'll need to employ a different strategy for gathering entities. We'll use something called a component group, which we'll initialize inside of the base class's onCreateManager method, using getComponentGroup, which is also part of the base class. GetComponentGroup expects a list of component types. It's using the same concept that we used when we created data structs. We're defining which components we want this system to operate on. Now, we need to call the component group's setFilterChanged method and pass in the type for the firing component. This is how we tell the firing system to react only to changes that are made to the entities it operates on. In this case, it'll react to the addition of the firing component. Reacting to other changes, such as removals, is not yet supported. Now, we need to refactor the firing job so it extends iJobParallel4. We'll need to pass in the position and rotation components as well. Now we can use component groups calculate length and component data array methods to finish scheduling the job. And that's all there is to it. Let's switch back to the editor and see this in action. Beautiful. This is exactly the behavior we want to see. And with that, player shooting is complete. If you'd like to download the project files for this video and support my content at the same time, please consider becoming a Tier 2 patron today. You can find a download link in the description and comments below. Well, we finally did it. We've completed player shooting. I haven't quite decided what to work on next, so I figured I'd ask you guys. Leave a comment letting me know what you'd like to see in Part 8. Or join us on Discord where you can ask your question and then just hang out with us. If you found this video helpful, please leave a like and a comment letting me know what you thought. And for more Unity tutorials just like this one, don't forget to subscribe with notifications on. I'll catch you guys in the next video. Thank you to all of my patrons, and a special shout out to Thomas, Chance McDonald, Glasswell Entertainment, Richard Stance, and Yakov.